Life Indian Fellowship, and so glad to be here with all of you this morning. And as Pastor Michael mentioned, that Pastor Josh has gone where Jim was supposed to preach this morning in Massillon, Ohio. So please pray for him, as he's been really affected by this. And this is the time we as a church, we need to come around him and pray for him, right? Yeah. That's what we do. That's how we do church. So if you're a guest here, if you're visiting us, go ahead and grab a connect card that is located in the back pocket of the seat. Just grab that, fill it up, and drop it off when the offering bags come by. That's just the way we get to know you a little better. In fact, that's going to help us. How can we serve you? So if you have a prayer request, let us know. If you have a praise report, let us know. And we'll pray for you and we'll rejoice with you as well. Well, we are back in Acts. We started our journey in the book of Acts. That's what we do here at New Life. We go through the books of the Bible. We believe that God's Word has power to change and transform our lives. And I certainly am an example of that. And I do believe that many of you who are here, you can agree with me. So we continue our journey in book of Acts. And last week, Pastor Josh kind of rebooted our journey. We took some time off during the month of Christmas, and we talked about the Advent series, but now we're back in Acts chapter 2. So if you have your Bible, open up your Bible to Acts chapter 2, and I'll read from verse 42 onwards. In fact, if you don't have a Bible, you can look up here on a screen and just follow along. Acts 2, verse 42 till 47. This is what it says. And they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And awe came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were being done through the apostles. And all who believed were together and had all things in common. And they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing the proceeds to all, as any had need. And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking of bread in their homes, they received their food with gladness and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved. Acts chapter 2. Let me give you a little background here. The story starts as Jesus is risen and he says to his disciples, listen up guys, I'm going to leave in a few days here. But once I'm gone, the Holy Spirit is going to come. So what I want you to do is go back to Jerusalem and stay there and wait for the promise of the Father, which is the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit came on the day of Pentecost, and all these disciples who were in the upper room, they were filled with the Holy Spirit. They began to speak in the language that they never learned before, and all of a sudden, those people who were there for this particular feast called Feast of Pentecost, from different nations, they were there, and they heard these people speaking in their own language. And so they were confused, perplexed, didn't realize what was happening, and all of a sudden, Peter stood up and he began to preach. And as Peter preached, people had to stop him and say, hey, wait, Peter, hang on. What must we do? And Peter says, repent, turn to Jesus and be saved, right? And 3,000 people were saved. Wow, that's awesome. I want to see that one day happening as I preach. And 3,000 people would say yes to Jesus. Amen? Okay, come on, somebody encourage me. Say it can happen. Yes. So 3,000 people were saved on the day of Pentecost, and they were all baptized. And here we are in Acts chapter 2, verse 42. It tells us that they devoted themselves to these four things. Acts 2:42 tells us that they devoted themselves to, one, apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread, and prayer. And last week, Pastor Josh talked about how we as a church, we need to devote ourselves to God's Word. This is God's Word. We believe with all our hearts that the Bible is not just an ordinary book on your bookshelf. This is the book. This is powerful. It's powerful stuff, man. This is God's Word. It can turn your life around. And the Bible tells us that the first church, the early church, they devoted themselves to apostles' doctrine, but also they devoted themselves to fellowship. But before we get into the fellowship part, I want to ask you this question. What is devotion? Fairly, it's a religious word, right? People, there are devotees who devote themselves to certain ideas and religion and things like that. What is devotion? Devotion is this willful dedication. If I can make it clear, it's something that they did not. Listen, the cool thing about this is that no one asked them to, no one forced them to. They never got an email that said, hey, come be part of our church. They devoted themselves. So as I was reading, I asked, what made them devote themselves? And the answer is simple. They heard the gospel. Peter preached, right? But not only that, they heard the gospel, they understood the gospel. It's two different things. It's one thing to hear. Many of us are here and we have heard the gospel. We know Jesus came, Jesus died, Jesus went back, and he's coming. We know all, so we are well informed, but not well taught. So gospel is this simple truth that Jesus saves. Jesus came to save the sinners. And listen, if you are here and you qualify yourself as a sinner, I have a good news. Jesus can save you. The only qualification that you need to be saved is that you have to be a sinner. There are many sinners in this room. And as Paul, I can say, I'm the worst. Whoa, what's happening? The presence of the Lord is here. But they devoted themselves. This is beautiful that they devoted themselves because they understood the gospel. So what they did was a reflection, or rather it was something that happened inside of them before it happened outside. Their hearts were changed. And they devoted themselves to these four things, as I said. And I want to talk about fellowship. Well, probably one of the most churchy words, right? Fellowship. What comes in your mind when I say the word fellowship? Probably you think fellowship as is the name of some church, like New Life Indian Fellowship. It's a good church. I go there every Saturday. If you haven't been there, the Lord's going to smite you, okay? No, I'm just kidding, okay? Don't be mad at me. Don't write it to me. I'll throw it away. What is fellowship? I'm just kidding. Okay, I love you guys. You know that, right? Okay, you know my humor. All right, good. I'm glad you do. What is fellowship? It's probably a name of a church, or maybe some of us think we have a fellowship hall down here, or maybe we think fellowship as a bunch of Christians, just they get together and they worship and they sing some songs and they do Bible study and you know, all kind of stuff. So what exactly is fellowship? When we see the word fellowship here in Acts 2:42, what it is? What is it? English. Fellowship is this beautiful word in Greek. In Acts 2:42, it says they devoted themselves to fellowship. It's a fascinating word in Greek. It says koinonia. Heard that before? Which means you have been in church for a long time. Koinonia, and koinonia is such a fascinating, it's so packed that there is no English word that can fully do justice. It cannot unpack it fully. There is no English word. Koinonia is this idea. I mean, there are two central ideas about this word koinonia. One is that this deep, intimate sharing of one's self with another. It's not just Sunday. We come and do things, which is absolutely important. Don't get me wrong. This is important stuff. But this is not it. It is this intimate sharing of one's self to another. But it also means contribution. So what we want to do is we're going to look at these two things this morning. We want to see how the early church, they devoted themselves to one another or each other, and they devoted themselves to contribution or generosity. We want to see these two things. So first, let's talk about being devoted to one another. I've got some stats here, okay? That's what happens when you spend time with Pastor Josh. Okay, you come up with a lot of stats. 46%, listen to me very carefully, church. 46% of Americans always or sometimes feel lonely. 46%. So as I look across this room, I see people who are lonely. And maybe here we have more than 46%. You know, the thing about us, we can wear a lot of masks. We are good actors. We can hide a lot of stuff. But deep down, we struggle. And many of us who are here, we struggle with loneliness. And not only that, in fact, we are living in a time where it seems like loneliness is just increasing rapidly. You know, a few weeks ago, we heard about coronavirus. It has become a global issue now. And everybody's paying attention to this. Wow, why? Because it can kill you, right? Listen, loneliness is no different. It doesn't kill you right away, but it kills you slowly. And the devil is so smart that he would never help us see these things. Okay, I got another research here. Listen to this. This is powerful. Pay attention. According to a study, a growing body of compelling evidence suggests that there is an epidemic of loneliness and social isolation in the United States with significant negative physical and mental health effects. Loneliness has negative effects on mental health, worsening depression, anxiety, mood disorders, and cognitive decline. And on physical health, leading to higher rates of cardiovascular impairment, chronic pain, and fatigue. Research indicates, for instance, now I know all these young people, they're going to hate me for this, but I don't care. Internet and social media engagement intensifies the feeling of loneliness, depression, and anxiety. I still love you guys, okay? You can hate me. Of a particular note, health risks associated with loneliness and social isolation are comparable to the danger of smoking and obesity, increasing mortality risk by up to 30%. We are living in a time where we are more lonely than ever before. I mean, the world is right here in palm of our hand. We know everything that's happening all around the world, and yet we are so disconnected. What has happened to us? Loneliness is a real thing. And oftentimes what people do is, in order to avoid loneliness, they come up with different ideas and strategies, right? Some of us become workaholics. We think, if I just work hard, if I just spend more time working, then I might not feel as lonely. But listen, that's not true. Workaholism doesn't solve the problem. In fact, it worsens it. If we think that if we come up with a plan, an idea, and then we can fix our lives, I tell you what, you might be able to fix your life for some time, but that's not the final solution, because you just can't. The answer is not within ourselves. It is fact that a lot of people turn to work. A lot of people turn to all kind of stuff to avoid this feeling of loneliness. But the good thing is that God always has a good news. I said God always has a good news. God always has a way out. Right? I mean, think about this, all of us, we were on our way to eternal damnation. Okay, the word called hell, I don't like to use it, but it's fact. Okay, it is. And we were on our way towards that, and all of a sudden, God intervenes and makes a way. So God always makes a way. So if you are here, and if you are struggling with loneliness, if you feel you are isolated, you feel worthlessness, listen, I do believe God has an answer for you. Look at Genesis chapter 2. Verse 18, can we have up on the screen? It says, Genesis 2:18, and the Lord God said, it is not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper fit for him. So Genesis 1:2, you all know what's the story in Genesis 1:2, right? It's creation account. Now, if you have never read Genesis 1 and 2, which means you have never read the Bible. That's the first book, first two chapters. God made everything, and God says, wow, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good. Finally, God made you and said, it's very good. But then finally, God said, well, there's something that's not good. There's one thing that is not the way it should be, and that thing is that it's not good that man should be alone. God doesn't want you to be alone. You know, God in himself is a triune being. He is a Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And he's always in fellowship with one another. Terence, can you explain Trinity? No. In the last 2,000 years, no one has ever been able to do that. And people who have tried have ended up becoming heretics. So I don't want to be a heretic. Okay? But God always has an answer. So God made man and then God made women, right? So all of you guys, listen to me. Your wife is your helper. Okay? Your wife is your helper. I know, listen, ladies, your husband will never accept the fact that he needs help, but he does. Okay? He does need help. We guys need help. And blessed are the women who know how to handle her husband. If you don't know how to do it, my wife can teach you how to do it. I love her. But listen, ladies, God made you a helper. Nagging is not part of helping. Someone is convicted in this room. Hey, it's not me, it's the Holy Spirit, okay? Don't blame me. As I said, don't write to me. But God made us as to live in community. God wants us to be in community because God is a communal being. He's one God, three beings. As I said, I can't explain that. But God wants us, his people, because we are created in his image. He wants us to represent him. So God made us for a community. So it is not good for us to be alone. So what's the answer? You know, I've heard this this one line some time ago. It says, the antidote for loneliness is to be alone with Jesus. Let me repeat that. The antidote for loneliness is to be alone with Jesus. And it's true, but it's just the one side of the coin. The other side of the coin, ladies and gentlemen, is the church. It is us. The church of Jesus Christ is the answer, is the answer to this epidemic of loneliness. God made us to be with one another, to love each other. And I tell you what, I am so blessed to have people in my life who has invested in me, who has shaped me, loved me, corrected me. And as you look around, I mean, you look to your right, you look to your left, there are people. The person sitting next to you, maybe it's your spouse. Your spouse needs you. And you need your spouse. At the same time, every single person in this room, we all need one another. We can't do this Christian life on our own. We are not Rambo. We need one another. We need help. We need people. I mean, we say this for a reason here at New Life, that God makes us family. Don't act like visitors. Act like family member. Do dishes. Do some chore. It's good to... Hey, we are family. Come on. You know, something about my wife. We live together, but there are people who come and visit us. They don't live there. They come, they eat, they go. Because they're not family. They are visitors. We are family. God made us for a reason, and God wants us to invest in one another, in each other. You can't grow on our own. That's just the fact. You can read the Bible day and night, and you'll end up having a lot of knowledge, but no growth. Because the Bible says, love one another. How are you going to love someone if you don't see someone? That's deep. We need people. In fact, in the New Testament, more than 50 times, we find this phrase, each other or one another. More than 50 times, which tells me that Christian life has to be in community. And I've got a list here, and I'm going to read some of them to convict you even more. John 13, 34, love one another. Romans 12, 10, be devoted to one another in brotherly love. John 12, 16, live in harmony with one another. Romans 15, 4, instruct one another. Galatians 5, 13, serve one another in love. Galatians 6, 2, carry each other's burdens. Ephesians 4, 32, be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other. Philippians 2, 3, in humility consider others better than yourself. Ouch. Hebrews 10, 25, encourage one another. James 5, 16, this is the hardest one probably. Confess your sins to each other. It's quiet. But that's what we do. We do life with one another. It's not just Sunday to Sunday. And listen, it's not just life group. We live as a family, as God's people, as brothers and sisters. You know, I love this story in John chapter 11, probably one of my favorite story in the Gospel of John. It's a story where Lazarus is dead, right? I mean, he is dead, and then he's actually sick, so they send a message and says, him whom you love is sick. I love that, poetic. Right? So him whom you love is sick. So Jesus says, well, I'm going to delay. And I find that very frustrating. Okay, Jesus is not Indian. That's not the reason why he's late. Okay. He's Jew. But he delays. And then finally, Lazarus is dead. He's gone. And then Jesus shows up, and Martha and Mary, if you were here 2 days ago or 3 days ago, and Jesus says, I am the resurrection and life. And then finally, he's standing in front of Lazarus' tomb. And in John 11, verse 44, we have these words. And the dead man, so Jesus stood in front of Lazarus and said, Lazarus, come out, right? So Lazarus came out, and it said, this is what it says. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a headcloth. And Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. So Lazarus came out, right? Hands bound, feet bound, mummified, came out. And everybody was terrified because he was mummified. I mean, come on. A dead person came back to life. I mean, and Jesus told them. Now, who are them? Those are the people who were there. Listen, as I see all of you, I see people who has been raised, spiritually speaking. Because of your faith in Jesus, all of us are like Lazarus. We are alive, but you know what? Bound in grave clothes. Alive. I mean, can you imagine Lazarus walking around in marketplace like this? And we do. We who are risen with Christ, it's a fact, it's a truth, that those of you who have believed in Jesus Christ, God has raised you. But we have this grave clothes around us. And I like the fact that it says it's around his hands, his feet, and his face. Listen, if you want this year, 2020, if you want to serve God, you need some people to come and unwrap your hands. Yeah? Lazarus could not fix himself. It would be kind of tough to do that. If you want to be this year, 2020, as a year where you want to grow in your walk with Jesus, you want to go where Jesus will send you, and you want to do that? Plug in with people who are going to unwrap your feet. You need those people. I need those people. If you are struggling with self-worth and you are finding yourself struggling, you determine your life and everything based on your feelings, and you just are always here and there. You don't know what life is and who you are. If you want to find out your identity, who are you in Christ Jesus, you need people who can unwrap your face, show you. It might be hurtful. Okay, it might be hurtful, but surround yourself with people who would love you. And I am, as I said, I'm so thankful. As I look across this room, I see people who has invested in me. I mean, 2 years ago, before I became a pastor here at New Life, man, I was a timid person. Trust me, I would be the last person in this room to stand up on a pulpit and preach. But God does his work in a way that is so wonderful. And then when God set people like me up here, you know it's God. You know for a fact that this has to be God, because no way. So they devoted themselves to one another. Church, it's time that we devote ourselves to one another. Look around in this room. There are people who are lonely. They're broken. They need a mentor. They need someone to disciple. They need someone who can just, you know, put a hand around their shoulder and just walk and not talk. Just walk. Just walk. We need one another. So they devoted themselves to one another, but they also devoted themselves to this thing called generosity. The early church was generous. Okay, look at Acts 2, 44 and 45. This is what it says in Acts chapter 2, verse 44 and 45. It says, and all who believed were together and had all things in common, and they were selling their possessions and belongings and distributing their proceeds to all as any had need. So church, this is what we're going to do today, okay? You need application. Go home. Get rid of your stuff. Sell your property. Okay? We all come and live here. How about that? If you like Indian food, my wife is pretty good at making Indian food. Right? That's what they did. But that's not what we do. And that's not the point. The principle is this, that Christians ought to be generous. You know, love is a verb. It's an action. So we, as followers of Jesus Christ, we got to follow his example. So God in Bible tells us that he loves us, right? But then he also demonstrated his love for us. Romans 5 tells us that, yet while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And this is how he demonstrated his love for us. So as followers of Jesus Christ, we got to do the same. So we don't just say, I love you, which is an important thing to do, right? Words are powerful. Make sure you tell your spouse and the people who are in your life, make sure you tell them that you love them before it's too late. But also we practice love. We show love. So what does it mean to be generous? And oftentimes the word generosity has to do, you know, by default we think of money. All they want in the church is money, money, money. Listen, that's not true. Generosity has to do more with your time and your talent than your treasure. God has given you time. God has given you treasure. God has given you talent. Be generous with all that you have. Because to start with, it's not yours. We live in this delusion that it's mine. No, he gave you for a reason. Be a good steward. So we got to be generous with all that we have, not just money. Yes, money is important part of this. You know, in 2 Corinthians 9, Paul is writing this letter to the church in Corinth, and he says, you know what, I want you to give money. Paul is telling to the church, and he says, I want you to give money because people in Jerusalem are struggling because of the famine. They are in need. Your brothers and sisters who are there, they need your support, and you better give. Paul is audacious, man. He's like, give. He's not requesting. He's telling them to give. And that's what we do. In fact, Pastor Josh talked about a couple of weeks ago how we want to partner with an organization in India called Project Rescue. I mean, there are places where they go. We can't go. The things that they do, we can't do. So what do? We support. That's the right thing to do as Christians. That's how we show that we love one another. So church is here, yes. But the church is bigger than this. It's all over the world. It's called the body of Jesus Christ. Amen. So I was in my class Thursday, and my professor shared this, which really kind of engraved on my heart. His name is Jim College. And he said this. He said, Christians ought to be people with open hands. Say open hands. Right? We got to be like this, open hands. Now, the thing with open hands is that people come and take from your hands. Right? People come and take, and sometimes people abuse because you have open hands. We are generous. And when that happens, when people take, you know what we do? We do this. We do this. And that's very natural. That just happens. Now, the good thing about this is that people can take no longer, which I don't think is a good thing, but at least we think it's a good thing. Right? We do this and we think we are. Now no one can take. But you know the bad thing about this is that God cannot add anymore. If you have this, God can't add. You do this, God gives. Simple but powerful. What would happen? How would it look like if we just began to live life like this? Generous, crazy, generous. Radically generous people. And as I said, not just with your money. Yes, listen, give, okay? And I'm not preaching this because after the sermon I'm going to get a pay raise. No. I'm saying this because it's true. Jesus said, give and it shall be given to you. The same measure, pressed down, shaken together, it's going to be poured out in your bosom. So we give, and God will give us back. Now again, we give because God has given us. Okay, we are not giving to get more. That's religion, not relationship. We give because God has given, but you know what? Even when we give what God has given us, God adds. That's just the fact. This is not a prosperity gospel. This is truth. God gives. God is the greatest giver of all times. No one can outgive God. So we, as followers of Jesus Christ, this year, 2020, we want to devote ourselves to God's word, but also we want to devote ourselves to one another. We want to devote ourselves to giving, giving our time, our treasure, our talent. So this is the one thing that I want you to know. This is the year where God's going to ask you to do two things. Okay, one is God's going to ask you to serve, and the way God's going to ask you is through our leadership team. It's not going to open up heaven and say, hey, you, can you serve there? We're going to ask you to serve. Okay? I'm going to tap on your shoulder, Pastor Michael or somebody from our staff, Pastor Josh might say, hey, can you serve in nursery? Can you serve, make coffee? And guess what you're going to answer?
Yes.
Okay, louder.
Yes.
Oh, you of little faith. You're going to say yes. So yes, we're going to say yes to serving, but we're also going to say yes to giving. Listen, I'm not a salesman trying to get money out of your pocket, trust me. But it's just a fact. We ought to display our love for one another by being generous. So I'd like to invite our worship team to come up forward. And as they lead us into this time of reflection, I want you to do this simple thing. It's very simple. Just close your eyes, talk to Jesus, and say, Lord, what do you want me to do? If you want me to serve, tell me, what do you want me to do, Lord? Maybe God will bring someone's face, someone's name. Listen to the Holy Spirit. Listen to the Holy Spirit. You are going to serve this year like never before. Can we agree on that? Can we say amen to that?
Amen.
And we're going to give this year. Why? Because that's what we do. Close your eyes for the next few minutes. Spend some time with Jesus.